In 1914, Joe Hill, a union organizer, laborer, and songwriter, was accused of murder. Though many thought he was innocent, the following year, he was executed in Salt Lake City. Alfred Hayes penned a poem about the incident, which was set to music a few years later by Earl Robinson. This song soon became a favorite of the labor movement. Years later, evidence was uncovered that he was indeed nowhere near the murder site. Paul Robeson raised his voice with the song Joe Hill in support of all outsiders, underprivileged, the overlooked, repressed, and unheeded. Paul Robeson sang it in concerts, rallies, protest meetings, gatherings, and work sites wherever he was needed.
I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead. I never died, says he. I never died, says he. In Salt Lake City, Joe, says I, him standing by my bed. They framed you on a murder charge, says Joe, but I ain't dead. Says Joe, but I ain't dead. The copper bosses killed you, Joe. They shot you, Joe, says I. Takes more than guns to kill a man, says Joe. I didn't die. Says Joe, I didn't die. And standing there as big as life and smiling with his eyes, says Joe, what they can never kill, went on to organize, went on to organize. From San Diego up to Maine, in every mine and mill, where workers strike and organize, it's there you'll find Joe Hill. It's there you'll find Joe Hill. I dreamed I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Says I, but Joe, you're 10 years dead. I never died, says he. I never died, says he. I never died, says he.
All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances. One man in his time plays many parts. His acts are seven ages. First, the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. And then the schoolboy, with his bright morning face creeping like snails, unwillingly to school. Then the lover, sighing like furnace, with a woeful ballad made to his mistress' eyebrow. And then the soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the pard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation, even in the cannon's mouth. And then the justice, in fair round belly with good cape on line, with eyes severe, beard of formal cut, full of wise saws and modern instances. And so he plays his part. The sixth age shift into lean and slippered pantaloon, with spectacles on nose, pouch on side, his youthful hose well saved, a world too wide for his shrunk shank, and his big manly voice turning again to childish treble, pipes and whistles in his sound. Last scene of all that ends this strange, eventful history is second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything. A Renaissance man, Paul Robeson, was an all-American athlete, an actor, singer, jurist, a linguist. He was fluent in at least 12 languages. He was an internationally acclaimed artist and a valiant activist for all struggling and oppressed people. The music you will hear tonight are pieces that he often performed in concert, no matter where the concert might have been performed. As he sang in streets, at work sites, union halls, coal mines, open spaces, as well as the great music and concert halls of the world. The butterfly effect metaphor, that is, small events have a rippling effect creating significant outcome, comes into play for me with this music. Early on, there were two such events for me that had lasting effect on my musical life. The first, hearing William Warfield sing Old Man River in the remake of the film Showboat. Paul Robeson was in the original film. His magnificent voice, incredible artistry, and authentic emotional conviction resonated with a terribly shy, lonely, and frightened 10-year-old boy. I thought, perhaps it would be possible for me to sing my emotions and my feelings. A decade later, my brother-in-law, Howard Horry, gave me a long-playing album featuring Paul Robeson. Howard was Japanese-American, born here in California. Howard and his family spent his teenage years incarcerated in the internment camps during the Second World War. They lost everything. Howard had faced and continued to face this racism and bigotry throughout his life. He identified with Paul Robeson on many levels. The Japanese-American Nisei Press followed Paul Robeson's singing career as well as his efforts for obtaining rights for all people. I was overwhelmed with the sheer brilliance and beauty of Paul Robeson's artistry. As I became more informed, as I listened and I learned, I came to realize that he was a giant of the 20th century. At this time, I would like to please welcome to the stage my collaborator for this evening, Dr. Elden Little, a great friend and artist. Elden is exceptionally gifted and exceedingly generous as he shares his wisdom, knowledge, and musicianship with us all. Elden Little. I would like to begin with There Is a Balm in Gilead, an African-American folk song linked to my childhood, taken from Jeremiah chapter 8, verses 21 and 22, invoking not only a physical healing, but a healing of the spirit as well. My understanding of the world continues to evolve as my 72-year-old self learned this fall from my dear friend Robert Sims, an expert on African-American folk song. As he was lecturing my British and American art song class, there he explained that the text heals the sin-sick soul, calls for the healing and awakening of the enslaver.
There is a balm.
spirits and think my works in vain. And then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. There is a balm in Gilead to make wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. If you can preach like Peter, if you can pray like Paul, go home and tell your neighbor he died to save us all. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. To heal the sin-sick soul.
The hymn Amazing Grace has a fascinating history. John Newton, an enslaver, was caught in a terrible storm at sea in a ship full of the enslaved. He was able to ride out the storm and had a spiritual awakening of sorts. He penned the text to what was to become a cherished hymn, but it was many years after he left the trade that he renounced it. He wrote, "It will always be a subject of humiliating reflection to me that I was once an active instrument in a business at which my heart now shudders." He became an active abolitionist and lived to see the Abolition of Slavery Act passed in 1807 by the British government, led by William Wilberforce. My own ancestor, Elihu Embree, who had been an enslaver, also had an awakening in the early 19th century, and he became an early anti-slavery voice in America, harsh and severe in his condemnation. He published the first newspaper devoted to the abolition of slavery in America, entitled The Emancipator. It was published in 1820. And it brings to mind an echo from my youth in the 1960s, a quote from Rabbi Taffan of the first century AD. "It was not granted you to complete the task, and yet you may not give it up."
That's it.
The next song, Oh No John, is a folk song from the British Isles. Paul Robeson often performed this in concert, and I include it as it was the first song I performed in competition. I was 13 or 14, and the ripple of this butterfly effect had created an incipient storyteller.
Stands a creature whose she is I do not know. I'll go and court her for her beauty. She must answer yes or no. Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no. My father was a Spanish captain, went to sea a month ago. First he kissed me, then he left me, bid me always answer no. Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no. Oh, madam, in your face is beauty, on your lips red roses grow. Will you have me for your lover? Madam, answer yes or no. Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no. Oh, madam, I will give you jewels if you will not be my wife. I will buy you silken dresses. Madam, will you marry me? Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no. Oh, madam, since you are so cruel, and that you have scorned me so, if I may not be your lover, madam, will you let me go? Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no. Then I will stay with you forever, if you will not be unkind. Madam, I have vowed to love you. Would you have me change my mind? Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no. Oh, hark, I hear the church bells ringing. Will you come and be my wife? Oh, dear madam, have you settled to live single all your life? Oh, no, John, no, John, no, John, no.
During a run of Showboat in London in 1929, Paul Robeson heard singing in the street. Welsh miners who had walked all the way from South Wales, from the South Wales valleys to protest low wages and poor working conditions. Robeson ended up marching with them and paying their train fare home. He became an advocate for their cause. His moral and financial support of the Welsh working class earned him the loyalty of the nation, a bond reinforced with transatlantic broadcasts during the years his passport was revoked. Thousands bought tickets to watch a bare stage displaying a large photograph of Robeson. The film Proud Valley has Robeson as the central character, arriving in pre-World War II Wales, looking for work, bonding with the locals in music, work, and song. He fights to improve working conditions for the miners, sacrificing himself in the end to save lives. A remarkable film in which he utilizes his multifaceted talents to create a memorable hero. It was Robeson's favorite film.
Sleep, my child, and peace attend thee all through the night. Guardian angels God will send thee all through the
This is a personal rumination on going home. My siblings are all writers, and years ago they introduced me to the Welsh sense of hiraeth, defined as a homesickness or nostalgia, a deep and irrational bond felt for a time, era, place, or person. My COVID-induced nostalgia has often taken me back, in heartfelt gratitude, to my youth in the sandhills of Nebraska, my student days in Berlin, and my many years of living in New Orleans, where the music of so many cultures united to create the thick roux of emotion, celebration, joy, and sorrow that is American music. The melody for Going Home was adapted from Dvorak's New World Symphony by his student, William Arms Fisher. In 1892, Dvorak became the director of the National Conservatory of Music of America. The conservatory welcomed students of all ethnic and cultural ties. Dvorak was introduced to the plantation songs, sorrow songs, and spirituals by his student H.T. Burley. The melodies that Burley had learned from his family members and others, many of whom had been enslaved. Burley, a brilliant composer in his own right, arranged and adapted many of these spirituals to our great fortune. Dvorak felt this was truly American music. I find in Going Home a sense that we can be brought together as a community in music, in the arts, in spirit, in love and grace, a sense of longing and a sense of gathering as one family. Robeson, was truly a great man, a great American, a great artist, a great intellect, and a soaring spirit in the fight for human rights. He earned a scholarship to Rutgers. He earned a scholarship to Rutgers University, placing first in a statewide competition. He went on to earn 12 letters in varsity sports, a two-time All-American in football, and was valedictorian of his class. He played professional football, received a law degree from Columbia University, and he went on to become a great star of the concert stage, Broadway theater, and film. He had everything, and yet was willing to risk all for the rights of all and of all humanity. The following is quoted from the Smithsonian Magazine article from September 2011, written by Gilbert King. Quote, "In April 1949, just as the Cold War was beginning to intensify, actor, singer, and civil rights activist Paul Robeson traveled to France to attend the Soviet Union-sponsored Paris Peace Conference. After singing Joe Hill, Robeson addressed the audience and began speaking extemporaneously, as he often did, about the lives of black people in the United States. Robeson's main point was that World War III was not inevitable, as many Americans did not want war with the Soviet Union. Before he took the stage, however, his speech had somehow already been transcribed and dispatched back to the United States by the Associated Press. By the following day, editorialists and politicians had branded Robeson a communist traitor for insinuating that black America would not fight in a war against the Soviet Union. Historians would later discover that Robeson had been misquoted, but the damage had been almost instantly done. Robeson's passport was soon revoked, and 85 of his planned concerts in the United States were canceled." Unquote. His strange, eventful history was an extraordinary life. His last days were spent in relative anonymity, in depression and ill health. The years of stress and defiance and the struggle, as well as head injuries sustained during his football career, had taken their toll. I remember his death being announced on the Armed Forces Radio Network in January 1976. I was a student in Berlin. Thankfully, there has been a resurgence of interest in his great influence and artistry. The following recording is from a concert at Carnegie Hall on May 9, 1958. The Supreme Court had just ruled that the right to travel is one of a citizen's inalienable rights, and his passport was restored. In the song sung today, in the version today, Robeson takes his signature song, Old Man River, and defiantly and triumphantly alters the lyrics. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Paul Robeson.
There's an old man called the Mississippi. That's the old man I don't like to be. What does he care if the world's got troubles? What does he care if the land ain't free? Old Man River, that old man River, he must know something, but don't say nothing. He just keeps rolling, he keeps on.
Gets a little drunk and you lands in jail became you show a little grit and you land in jail.
Them that plan Sam is soon forgotten, but old man River, he just keeps rolling along. You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and wrecked with pain. Tote that barge, lift that bale, you show a little grit, and you land in
happen instead of crying? I must keep fighting until I'm dying. And old man revered, he'll just keep rolling along.
I would say that's a tough act to follow. Tonight, we are here to honor two great Americans. Our concert in the brochure was titled Songs to Reopen the World, of course, for COVID. In your program, it's titled Songs to Open the World. Paul Robeson and Marian Anderson used their voices to open the world of music to those who had been denied the opportunities to use their gifts and to open the eyes and ears of the world that thought certain people were less than others. As Harold Ickes says, and you'll hear him say it, on the Easter Sunday concert, genius draws no color line. Today is the day after Marian Anderson's 125th birthday. Yesterday was her birthday. She was born in Philadelphia, about 45 miles down the river from where Paul Robeson was born. He was born around Princeton and she was born in Philly. She had an innate connection to music and a mature voice even as a child. Her ear was to the door of any room in which music was being made. Because of this incredible gift, as a child of six, she was already singing. I wouldn't call them concerts, but she would go to different churches and sing a number. She never missed a Sunday singing in church, and she sang all the parts. In her autobiography, she says, one Sunday she went and they were doing the Inflamato Zest, and the soprano didn't show up, so the choir director just said, you sing it. And she did. And she said, and those high C's were so easy for a contralto. The church of which she was a part would support her through her entire career and enable her to fulfill her promise and support her until she graduated from high school at age 24. The director of the People's Choir in Philadelphia, E. Azalea Hackley. I don't know if any of you know that name, but if you don't, you need to read up about her. She was a conductor and educator, and she left Philadelphia to go to Chicago to start a music conservatory. But right here in Detroit, at our own Detroit Public Library, is housed the E. Azalea Hackley collection, and that houses the records of historic African-American performing arts performers. The church and conviction, the start of Marian Anderson's career. I dedicate one of her favorite Bach arias to this period of her life, Erbarme dich, mein Gott, have mercy, Lord. This aria speaks of Simon Peter's sorrow for denying Christ three times. Miss Anderson knew her own sorrows. The death of her father when she was 12, having to leave school and work to support her mother and her sisters. She had to drop out. And the indignities of being denied entry into a conservatory of music in Philadelphia because of her color. I think these experiences imbue everything she sang with the depth and intensity that the world responded to her in her voice. So now I'd like to bring Professor Ifu Wan and Dr. Little back for this piece. Philadelphia is very close to New Jersey, where I'm from, and where Thomas Edison was, and where the recording industry started. Marian Anderson recorded the first spirituals on a major label, RCA Victor, in 1923. We will hear her Deep River, arranged by H.T. Burley, of whom you have already heard. He wrote many of the arrangements that she did, and she always, always programmed spirituals on her concerts. She made many incredible recordings during her career, and I really recommend you search them out. I listened to many of her recordings when I was young, and as I said, the intensity, the vulnerability, the dignity just comes right through the speakers directly to you. Now we're going to hear her sing Deep River, 1923. Marian Anderson wanted to become the most expert interpreter of songs she loved. And she realized that to be able to do that, she needed to know the languages and styles intimately. And in order to do that, she would have to go to Europe. Many African Americans made that journey as their acceptance in countries that were not segregated offered greater opportunities. Again, her church and the Rosenwald Foundation came through. They found money to help her travel, to get her clothes, and the Rosenwald Foundation gave her $750 to take the boat and go to Europe. During the time she spent in Europe, she sang hundreds of concerts, many in Scandinavia, Austria, Russia. She became an artist of international acclaim, and Scandinavia was taken with what they called Marian fever. While there, Arturo Toscanini heard her. You know Toscanini, one of the most famous conductors of the 20th century, called hers the voice that one hears once in 100 years. While in London, she stayed at the home of Mr. Payne, an African-American singer and actor, and he was vital in the community, the artistic community there, introduced her to many people, one of whom was Roger Quilter, who became her friend, and who arranged this next piece, I've Got a Robe, or Heaven, Heaven, for her concert at Wigmore Hall. She sang the most with orchestras all over the world is a piece that I love, the Brahms Alto Rhapsody. Unlike her friend and fellow activist Paul Robeson, who was a very vocal speaker against prejudice and injustice, Marian Anderson was a reluctant activist. This is a quote. Certainly, I have my feelings about conditions that affect my people. But it is not right for me to mimic someone who writes or speaks out against segregation. That is their fort. What I had was singing. And if my career has been of consequence, then that's my contribution. This text that Brahms set speaks of one tone, one sound, being able to change one's heart, and her voice changed many.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, this woman of enormous fame, world-renowned, comes home to the United States. Her manager is arranging an important concert for her. The Carnegie Hall of Washington, D.C., the largest hall there, is called Constitution Hall. It seats 4,000. So Mr. Hurok asked if they could have a concert. Constitution Hall is owned by the Daughters of the American Revolution, and they denied Marian Anderson's concert. However, she had a strong supporter in Mrs. Eleanor Roosevelt, who, hearing about this, resigned her membership and worked with the Secretary of State, Harold Ickes, to arrange another venue. That venue was the Lincoln Memorial, and on Easter Sunday, 1939, Marian Anderson stood before a crowd of 75,000 people and sang this concert, not to mention the millions who heard it on the radio. So, 4,075 millions. Sometimes things work for the good. That was an historic event and was part of the momentum to end segregation in this country. Another historic event: in 1955, Marian Anderson became the first African-American to sing at the Metropolitan Opera. She sang in Balo in Mascara. It took many years, and she and Paul Robeson were two artists that used their platform and raised their voices for others. At this time, I'd like to thank John Reed, David Rail, and the members of our choir that joined us tonight. And we are now going to see Marian Anderson live, 1939, sing My Country, 'Tis of Thee.
Genius, genius draws no color line. And so it is fitting that Marian Anderson should raise her voice in tribute to the noble Lincoln, whom mankind will ever honor. Miss Marian Anderson.
In the College of Music, we have students and faculty from many nations, many cultures, and many different experiences that come together to share in making music. We are proud to be a part of this. 2 weeks ago, I heard a concert at the Wharton Center with all these young people playing Shostakovich Symphony, another genius who was forced to create under the thumb of a dictator. Last week, our students gave a Color Me Music concert at Murray Hall. The room was filled with joy and exuberance. We see music in action. I would invite you to keep your eyes peeled. WKAR is going to have a series, Music for Social Justice, that the faculty at the School of Music has, and students have put together, and shortly it will be on TV. I would like to leave you with the last words of Marian Anderson's autobiography. There are many persons ready to do what is right because in their hearts they know it is right, but they hesitate, waiting for the other person to make the first move, and he in turn waits for you. The minute a person whose word means a great deal dares to take the open-hearted and courageous way, many others follow. Not everyone can be turned aside from meanness and hatred, but the great majority of Americans are heading in that direction. I have a great belief in the future of my people and my country. And now, if you will turn in your programs and be ready, there's text on the personnel page, because we're going to be asking you to join in song.
In 1973, Paul Robeson Jr. and Harry Belafonte presented a 75th birthday celebration at Carnegie Hall, honoring Paul Robeson. Robeson was too fragile to attend, but he wrote, "Though I have not been active for several years, I want you to know that I am still the same Paul, dedicated as ever to the worldwide cause of humanity for freedom, peace, and brotherhood." Jane and I want to thank you all so much for joining us this evening. We want to thank Dr. Rail and Dr. Reed and the gentlemen of the chorus. We would also like to express our gratitude to Phyllis Green and to Randy Cohen for their generous support of this program and support of the College of Music here at MSU. Our final song is taken from the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven with the text by Schiller. You are welcome to join us on the second verse, printed in the program, with the text that Paul Robeson included in his performance. Let the words of Dr. Martin Luther King echo and re-echo in the halls. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice.
Our Ukrainian brethren.